Good morning. Can I remind members of the COVID-related measures that are in place and that face coverings should be worn when moving around the Chamber and across the Holyrood campus? The first item of business is general questions, and at question number one, I call Rachel Hamilton.
To ask the Scottish Government what action it is taking to support the red meat industry.
Cabinet Secretary Marie Goujon.
This government has a strong track record of supporting Scotland's red meat industry. We campaigned for years for repatriation of the red meat levy, which was eventually implemented through a UK Act, and this will generate around £1.5 million annually to promote our red meat sector. And we recently supported QMS's Scotch Lamb campaign around St Andrew's Day, and in response to ongoing issues in our pig sector, we've provided a hardship support scheme and also recently opened a private storage aid scheme to take pressure off the industry. And finally, unlike other parts of the UK, we continue to provide additional support for suckler beef and sheep producers, with payments due to start under the latter scheme in April and May next year.
Rachel Hamilton.
I thank the Cabinet Secretary for that answer. Presiding Officer, we are now down to 26 red meat abattoirs in Scotland and, shockingly, only 15 female butchers. Cabinet Secretary, what do you say to the Rare Breeds Survival Trust, who say that your government has failed to address the local abattoir crisis in Scotland?
Cabinet Secretary.
Now, I absolutely understand the importance of local slaughter provision in the red meat sector, and we do have relatively good coverage. However, we absolutely recognise that there might be occasions where local slaughter needs aren't immediately met, and there are obviously several reasons why that might be the case. There's whether that's throughput or costs, because that appropriate throughput is vital for abattoirs to ensure that plants do have a viable future. And unfortunately, this isn't the case with low local demand, which can sometimes make the long-term viability an ongoing issue. And the Scottish Government and Food Standards Scotland would be happy to discuss with any organisation who are considering operating an abattoir in Scotland.
Question number two, Michael Mara.
To ask the Scottish Government what its response is to the achievement of Curriculum for Excellence level statistics.
Cabinet Secretary Shirley-Ann Somerville.
I refer Michael Mara to my statement on Tuesday 14th of December, the accompanying National Improvement Framework Plan, also published earlier this week, and the Government's Actions on Education Recovery, published in October.
Michael Mara.
I thank the Minister for that answer. This is a defining moment for Scottish education. These statistics show the lowest attainment on record under Curriculum for Excellence and an increase in what was already a staggering attainment gap. In response, the Minister has cut attainment challenge funding to this year to the levels of 2017 and plans to return teacher numbers to what they were when the SNP took office in 2007. There is nothing in these plans to respond now to this urgent situation. Can we really have confidence that a failing pre-pandemic plan can protect the life chances of a pandemic generation?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, I would point Mr Mara to the fact that before the pandemic, the year-on-year trend in the ASL data was positive. We are already taking action to ensure that we are supporting children and young people during this difficult time. For example, through the increase in the Scottish Attainment Challenge funding from £750 million in the last Parliament to £1 billion in this, the statistics that came out on Tuesday also pointed to an additional 2,000 teachers since 2019. And, of course, a low pupil-to-teacher ratio. That's a determination that we are continuing to carry on with, and that's exactly why we have our manifesto commitment for 3,500 additional teachers and 500 support staff. As I said to Mr Mara, we are already on track to deliver that.
Oliver Mundell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Our schools went into this pandemic underprepared after the SNP cut teacher numbers to the bone. Does the new teacher numbers announced amount to a recognition that the SNP just got this wrong?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, what we've made absolutely clear in our work as we move towards recovery, and indeed still as we deal with the pandemic, is to ensure that we're supporting our schools and local authorities to be able to support children and young people through additional teachers. That will, of course, ensure that we continue to assist children and young people at this very difficult time, and will, of course, ensure that we assist those children and young people in the longer term, as with the baselining of the money for the additional teachers, we will see a greater opportunity for permanent contracts, and rightly so, for our teaching workforce.
Bo Cab-Stewart.
Thank you. Could I ask the Cabinet Secretary what lessons can be learned from across the UK and around the world about the impact of the pandemic on our education system?
Briefly, Cabinet Secretary.
Well, this COCAP Stewart raises a very important point, that the challenges that we are facing that were shown in the ASIL statistics are not unique to Scotland. Indeed, recent reports from Ofsted and the World Bank and others show that there will be an impact on many, indeed not most, children. That's exactly why we're taking the action that we did, as I mentioned, in teacher numbers and in attainment challenge funding increasing.
Question number three, Katie Clark.
To ask the Scottish Government what recent discussions it has had regarding the Hunterston Park development.
Minister Ivan McKee.
I refer the member to questions SW604431 and SW604432 from Jamie Green, MSP, where I set out that Scottish Enterprise continue to engage with Peel Ports and North Ayrshire Council Under a memorandum of understanding to secure delivery of regional and national investment objectives at Hunterston. There have been no visits by senior Scottish Government representatives to the site since 1 January 2021. However, Scottish Government planning officials did attend an online meeting with Peel Port representatives about the Hunterston Park development in November 2020.
Katie Clark.
As the Minister will know, the site now owned by Peel was designated for industrial use many decades ago, but is a beauty spot, an area of environmental importance with many diverse biodiversity issues, a site of special scientific importance and very close to communities. Hunterston B has stopped generation and North Ayrshire Council have set up a task force, but their ambition was always that the Scottish Government should be involved with a ministerial task force to look at development of the site. Would the Minister be willing to look at a ministerial task force that would also involve North Ayrshire Council, the trade unions, the landowner, employers and community representatives, in particular community councils, with a view to ensuring job creation and also delivering on our environmental commitments?
Minister.
The member is correct to identify the importance of biodiversity and special scientific interests, and of course each planning application well, the site is considered on its merits and biodiversity matters would be considered as part of that process. With regards to the substance of her question, I'd be very happy to meet with the stakeholders she identified the best way to move forward with the site, given, as I've said, that Scottish Enterprise are working with Peel Ports on a memorandum of understanding and work is progressing in that regard. But with regard to wider stakeholder engagement, I would be, as I said, very happy to have appropriate meetings and to determine the best way to ensure ministerial engagement going forward.
Kenneth Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Does the Minister agree that Hunterston Port and Resource Centre in my constituency is vital to the economic regeneration and green transition of North Ayrshire, and will the Scottish Government and its agencies redouble their efforts in pursuit of potential investors who will bring skilled and well-remunerated employment to the area?
Minister.
Recognising strategic importance, Hunterston is a proposed national development in the draft National Planning Framework 4, which has been laid in Parliament and is currently being consulted on. Hunterston has also been selected as one of the projects in the Ayrshire Growth Deal to drive sustainable, inclusive growth. As I said, Scottish Enterprise continue to be closely engaged with Peel Ports and North Ayrshire Council under collaborating under a memorandum of understanding to advance and secure the delivery of national and regional investment objectives defined in the Scottish Government's inward investment strategy and the Ayrshire economic strategy. And as I said, my answer to Katie Clark, I am very happy to engage with other stakeholders to ensure that the work that's been done moves forward as quickly and effectively as possible.
Question number four, Christine Graham.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. To ask the Scottish Government what measures it has taken to support town centres.
Minister Tom Arthur.
We have been working with partners, including local government and Scotland's Towns Partnership, to build on the success of the Town Centre First principle and 2013 Town Centre Action Plan, supported by the Regeneration Capital Grant Fund, the £50 million Town Centre Fund and Business Improvement Districts. In 2020, we commissioned an independent review of the Town Centre Action Plan to build on this strong platform and in light of the climate emergency and the pandemic. We are working with COSLA to respond to the recommendations in the review report, A New Future for Scotland's Town Centres. Since 2020, we have provided more than £6 million additional support to town and community partnerships and business improvement districts. Earlier this year, we launched the £10 million Scotland Loves Local programme to support local businesses and town centres. All of this is underpinned by our £325 million place-based investment programme over this Parliament, which builds on the Town Centre Action Plan and Regeneration Capital Grant Fund to accelerate our ambitions for place, 20-minute neighbourhoods and town centre revitalisation.
Before I go back to Ms Graham, can I just say I appreciate the desire to provide comprehensive responses, but I would prefer more succinct questions and answers. Christine Graham.
Preempted my preamble to say that was a very comprehensive answer, but I want to move from funding, which is welcome, and just give two examples in my constituency of Midlothian, South Tweeddale and Lauderdale of Galashiels and Pennycook town centres where there are far too many large empty retail stores that have been empty for years, but it's difficult to trace the owners. Can I ask if the current compulsory purchase legislation is sufficient to permit a local authority to take ownership and redevelop possibly for a mix of housing in the town centre and smaller commercial outlets, because it doesn't seem to be happening.
Minister.
Can I thank Christine Graham for the question? I'll be as brief as I possibly can. Just to set the matter out, acquiring authorities are expected to carry out thorough land referencing in order to ascertain the ownership of land they intend to include within a compulsory purchase order. However, the inability to trace all owners is not necessarily a barrier to the use of compulsory powers, and current Scottish Government guidance covers this situation. We have, however, committed to a review of compulsory purchase legislation in Scotland, which will provide an opportunity to consider whether the current procedures are fit for purpose.
Siobhan Brown.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is along the same vein as Christine Graham. To ask the Scottish Government, what further action could be taken to help to improve the appearance of our town centres, with many shops lying empty and deteriorating, along with derelict land and buildings?
Minister.
Thank you, and can I thank Siobhan Brown for her question and congratulate her on her appointment as convener of the Towns and Town Centre Cross-Party Group. It is, of course, vital that we repurpose and reimagine our town centres going forward, broadening their offer and ensuring diversity so that they are not over-reliant on one sector. This is supported by the independent review of the Town Centre Action Plan, which published its report in February and advocated long-term sustainable actions built upon local partnerships. We are considering the report's recommendations with our partners and are working collaboratively to take forward our response, and I would be happy to meet with the member and the cross-party group to discuss the outcome of that process in due course.
Question 5 is not lodged. Question 6, Sarah Boyack.
To ask the Scottish Government what support and advice it plans to provide to enable the establishment of community heat and power networks to deliver net zero targets.
Minister Patrick Harvey.
As set out in the Heat in Buildings strategy, we'll invest £400 million over this Parliament to support the development of heat networks and low-carbon heat infrastructure at scale in Scotland. We'll also launch a heat network pre-capital support unit in 2022, which will help nurture opportunities for new networks and to expand existing ones. In addition, the Scottish Government's Community Renewable Energy Scheme CARES that utilises the local Energy Scotland network of regionally based development officers to provide advice and financial support to local communities who are looking to decarbonise their energy consumption.
Sarah Boyack.
Can I thank the Minister for that answer? Will the Minister confirm that local authorities and community groups need advance finance to establish those community and heat networks so that they can access expertise, risk assessment and feedback from what works with previous projects, so that the Scottish Government directly funds development work to enable those local authorities and community co-ops to get going on the new projects we need across Scotland to deliver the low-carbon heat and power we need and for the profits to be reinvested locally?
Minister.
Well, the Scottish Government, across the whole heat and building strategy, is very clear that a huge scale of investment is needed, and that's why we'll be creating a green heat finance task force to look at the wide range of options for increasing that investment. We are committed to supporting local communities as well as local government that want to maximise the deployment of heat networks, and we'll work collaboratively with local government and across the political spectrum to ensure that that happens.
Question number 7, Colin Beattie.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will provide an update on the proposed works at Sheriff Hall Roundabout as part of its £300 million commitment to the Edinburgh and South East Scotland City Region deal.
Minister Graham Day.
Presiding Officer, as I advised the Chamber on the 27th of October, we remain committed to delivering the grade separation of Sheriff Hall Roundabout. Following publication of draft orders, a significant number of objections were received, which Transport Scotland is currently trying to resolve. However, a public local inquiry may be required if objections cannot be resolved.
Colin Beattie.
I thank the Minister for his response. This area in my constituency is used heavily by my constituents and those in the surrounding areas every day, and often a bottleneck situation due to the volume of traffic develops, which is frustrating to road users. Can I ask what specific action the Scottish Government can take to address the delays to beginning the works at the Sheriff Hall roundabout, and can they provide any reassurance to my constituents that this is in hand?
Minister.
Presiding Officer, let me reassure the member that Transport Scotland is very much focused on trying to resolve the significant number of objection responses received following the publication of draft orders for the scheme, with, for example, replies having now been issued to nearly all of the objectors. However, as I said, given the number of objections received, there may need to be a public local inquiry to consider objections that are not withdrawn. Now, that would disappoint and frustrate me almost as much as it would the member, but I'm sure Mr Beattie would recognise that having set in place the opportunity for communities and stakeholders to have a say and involvement in key decisions on infrastructure like this, it is incumbent on all of us to respect that process and engage with it to the best of our abilities.
Question number 8, Gillian Mackay.
To ask the Scottish Government whether it will publish a timeframe for the implementation of the dog control database.
Minister Ash Regan. I'm going to move on to question 9 in the meantime, and can I call Richard Leonard? Bear with me, colleagues.
To ask the Scottish Government what its position is on the Scottish National Investment Bank's investment portfolio.
Cabinet Secretary Kate Forbes.
Well, the Scottish National Investment Bank is building its portfolio and making commercial investments in line with its missions, which of course relate to net zero place and innovation. And since its launch last year, the bank has committed to £137 million of investment, and it's on track to provide £200 million to Scottish businesses this financial year, and it's growing that investment pipeline in order so that it can apply at least another £200 million next year, which is of course a huge achievement for a new body that only began operations just over 12 months ago.
Richard Leonard.
Well, I know that the Minister always says that these investment decisions are matters for the board, and I'm all in favour of planting more trees. But doesn't the government have a view on the fact that the biggest investment by far, more than a third of the money allocated by this public bank, has been handed out to a private fund manager, Gresham House, which specialises in tax avoidance schemes for wealthy millionaires to plant trees, rather than to invest in the jobs and the industries that our people and our communities need?
Cabinet Secretary.
Well, the member is right in reminding the Chamber that these investment decisions are operational matters for the bank, and those decisions are taken independently of ministers. And of course, whilst opposition will call on those decisions to remain independent, it then is slightly strange when members ask questions of ministers that they don't agree with. The bank has been set up very specifically to invest commercially and to generate investment returns. It needs to invest alongside the private sector in order to deliver its purpose and have the impact that's required of it. And the majority of the bank's investments so far have net zero as a primary mission. And the bank's board determines how it invests. That investment independence is part of the important arrangements between the bank and the Scottish Government. And the last comment I would make is that the bank's ethical investment policy and the Fair Work Direction issued to the bank in August informs the bank's approach and underpins the covenants it puts in place when it makes an investment. So the bank only invests in businesses or projects that meet its ethical standards or are willing to commit to adopt these.
Thank you. Ms Mackay, unfortunately, we're unable to make contact with the Minister at the moment, but I'm sure a response will be provided.